Well, do you want the good news? This is part two of last week. So Jason, what does that usually mean?
We're getting out early.
I'll tell you what, that's what it usually means. So what we're going to get into tonight is we've been looking at perfecting our faith. We're going to be looking at Christian virtues, perfect faith. In fact, Paul's prayer for the Thessalonians that was read just a few moments ago not only included a desire here to be with them personally, but also a request that they develop traits of a Christian virtue. If we look at this again, it said, "The Lord make you increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all of his saints." Now, this would help perfect their faith if they did what this scripture said. But Peter also, other than talking about love abound, Peter also, if we look here in 2 Peter 1, 5, and 7, Peter said similar things that were also spoken in the previous verses. He said, "And besides this, giving all diligence to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity." What is charity? What's that word? That word is love. And if we do, I'll put up a list here of those that I just mentioned there. Love, brotherly kindness, you see, godliness, and perseverance, and self-control, and then you have knowledge, and then you have virtue, and then you have faith. And all of these, if we use these, they will help us to increase our faith in these virtues. And then, of course, news of their faith and love had spread basically worldwide. And we look here and see 1 Thessalonians 1 and 8. It says, "Far from you sounded out the word of the Lord not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to Godward is spread abroad, so that we need not to speak anything." But they were not to settle in. A lot of people settle in. They were not to settle in on their present level of love. And we shouldn't settle in on our present level of love, but we should increase our love. They were to make it, as it says in the scriptures, increase and abound. Abound and overflow like a fountain of love. That's how it should be. In 1 Thessalonians, the first, fourth chapter, and verse 9, and we'll look at Philippians 1 and 9, it says, "In this I pray that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment." Notice what it says, that your love may abound. So we're talking here about doing what? Love toward each other. We're talking about loving each other. And in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 10, it talks about that they love one another. It says, "But as touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you, for you yourselves are taught of God to love one another. And indeed you do it toward all the brethren, which are in all Macedonia, but we beseech you, brethren, that you increase more and more." Increase what? Increase their love toward one another. And then also in John 13, 34 through 35, he says, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another." And then it says, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one to another." So one of these virtues that we're talking about here is to have faith, and have it more abound is to have a lot of love in our lives. In 1 Peter 1 and 22, "Seeing you have purified your souls and obeying the truth to the spirit of, do you see that word? Unfeigned love. That also means sincere love of the brethren. See that you love one another with a pure heart, fervently. That word fervently is a desire that you love one another. And in 1 John 4:10-11, herein is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another toward all men, not just local congregation or even Christians, but we are to love everybody. Now, we've talked about things like, well, we love the person, we just don't like their lifestyle or like their sin. We don't like the way that they're living their life. But even God sent his son to the whole world, evil and good, sent him to die so that they could have a way to have eternal life. And that's where our job comes in that I spoke of this morning, being salesmen and trying to go sell the gospel. Next week, I'm going to tie a little more of that next week as we look at how did the church, early church, how did they sell the gospel of Jesus Christ? What did they do? And how did they get it done? And we'll take it all, I hope, when I've got it all put together, I'm going to hopefully look at all the book of Acts, and we're going to look at some things in the book of Acts to see how that they did it, how that they sold that gospel. The purpose for the practice of such love was to perfect their faith here in what we're studying about. And in 1 Thessalonians 3:13, it says, to the end he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. That word establish, that means basically establish is to fix. It is to make fast. It is to set from the root, meaning to prop. You may have done plays before and you had props there that were there to make things stable. Well, this is to establish and then blameless, so that no charge could be laid or sustained to anybody. As 1 Peter 2:11 says, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lust which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. And then it speaks of holiness. That means being separated. That means being consecrated. That means being devoted to Almighty God. So these virtues that we talked about are expressed in the reality of one's faith. One's faith toward God, and the practice of such will turn our faith into a faith that is being perfected. And then the next one I want to talk to you about is the awareness of the second coming perfects faith. You think about that. When Paul first arrived in Thessalonica from Philippi, he taught about Jesus. It says in 17:23, and Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preached unto you, is Christ. Faith in Jesus related to the past. Faith in Jesus related to the present. Faith in Jesus related to the future. From past, we're freed from the sin by the grace of Almighty God. And in the present, they were to live a virtuous life. Jesus in faith also related to the future. It talks about Christ coming in 1 Thessalonians 3:13. To the end, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I just put that up, and I want you to see what I've got underlined. At the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then we also have hope. What kind of hope? We hope in return of Jesus gives strength to our faith. We often get caught up in the present, don't we? We often get caught up in the right now. And then life begins to lose its purpose sometimes as we're going through our present. And sometimes it kind of loses meaning. And the power to resist evil in the present begins to fade, because a lot of people, if they can't resist it, they don't resist it, and they start falling away because they even don't resist it any more than they used to. They stay away from it. Remembering the Lord's return, I believe, revitalizes our faith. That's what I have to look forward to, is the coming of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I look for Him every single day. I ask every single day in my prayers, I said, Lord, are you coming today? Please come. I try to say exactly what it says in the end of Revelation. Come quickly, Lord Jesus, come. Because I want Him to come, because I want Him to take us away from all of this that we have that's just material things, and change our bodies and give us a body like unto His own glorious body. And all history is moving toward that final destruction. All history is moving toward that final destruction. It's been moving toward that final destruction since when? That's right. Since that time, it's been moving toward that final second coming that we're going to have. For it tells us in 2 Peter 3:10, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Do you notice that? The day of the Lord, the earth and also the works that are therein, what's going to happen to them? Just like this. It's all going to be burned up. Could that be why He tells us that when He comes, that those of us that are still alive, we're going to be caught up into the air? Do you really want to be on the earth when He comes back? There's going to be a lot of burning going on. Now, I know that we're all going to be changed, and we're going to be caught up into the air to meet the Lord. But what about those that don't get caught up? All we're told is that they're going to be cast into a what? A lake of fire. I don't actually believe that the earth is going to be the lake of fire, because He's going to burn that up. Maybe the sun is the lake of fire. Maybe that's what He's going to use. I don't know. But whatever it is, it's going to be a lake of fire, but it's not going to be a lake like we've ever seen. And there's going to be a lot of weeping and gnashing of teeth when that happens. In 2 Peter 3:11, it says, this should encourage our faithfulness. It says, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons are you to be in all holy, here it is now, conversation and godliness. So what's He telling us? That we look forward to the day the Lord comes. What should be happening concerning our conversations? It should be more holy conversation, and we should try to live a godly life as much as we can. In verse 12, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, where the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Besides the earth and all that going to be on fire, what else is going to be on fire? The heavens above us are going to be on fire. Now, you can have all the great movie effects that you've ever been to and looked at, but you ain't ever seen any movie effects that this is going to be. This is going to be something nobody's ever seen before, I promise you. And then 13, nevertheless, we, according to His promise, we look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. And you go to Revelation 21, it talks about, and He says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. So is He going to set up a new heaven and a new earth for us to abode in? Have no idea. It just says we look forward to new heavens and new earth. Faith. Faith is to look beyond the present and to see the ultimate purpose of God. In Hebrews 11 and 1 and verse 6, it says, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, but when he again brings the firstborn to the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him. Thereby one faith is molded and perfected. So what are we talking about tonight? Not only a new heaven and a new earth, but we're also talking about perfecting our faith is something we need to work at daily. It is a journey toward God when we're trying to perfect our faith every day. And there are many things that help us along this journey. And that is, we need to have relationships with fellow Christians. That's why he told us to all come together and to worship together and meet together. We need to be with those that are like us. We also need, we can perfect our faith when we're enduring trials, and especially those tribulations that come upon us. And we can also help to perfect our faith by overcoming temptations. And man, there's lots of temptations out there. It's almost everything you look at, you can't look at TV without seeing temptation of some kind. In fact, if you ought to die, you better stay away from TV, because temptation is going to make you want to go do what? It's going to make you want to go buy some of that food that they're showing on there. You got to watch those temptations. And then we perfect our faith by prayer. Man, the avenue of prayer, how wonderful that is to be able to talk to our God. And then perfect our faith in the Christian virtues, which we'll get into this on down the line as I look basically at the virtues that were all mentioned there as we're going to talk about all those. And then we perfect our faith because we have hope and we remember the second coming of Jesus Christ. As we wait to have that happen, as we wait to have the second coming of Jesus Christ, some days the travel will be easier than others. But some days our travel on this earth will be very, very hazardous. It'll be very complicated. Maybe we might lose a little bit of our faith toward God. Maybe people will wind up saying, is God really here? Is God with me? Why is God letting this all happen? Why has this all happened to me? Why is God letting this happen? There will be detours. There will be roadblocks that are expected. The devil is really great at trying to put things up in front of us to try to keep us from staying faithful. However, don't allow these to cause you, as it has other people, to quit their journey. Because it's what happens to people in the church. When they get their journey gets a little difficult, they quit. And then use the means God has provided to help you perfect your faith. You perfect your faith by saying to yourself, am I obedient to the faith? Am I doing everything that the book tells me to do concerning being obedient to the faith? Do I really have the faith that I need to have? Do I have the belief I need? Did I practice that faith and that belief? Do I repent of my sins on a daily basis so that I can change my life? When you get to that point, you're to the point that do I really confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God? That gives me a mission. That gives me a mission for my Lord and Savior to say to his Father and my Father that, yes, he knows who I am. He knows I'm his child. He knows that I'm one of his sheep. And then I'm baptized into Jesus for the remission of sins because I catch hold of his precious blood atonement that he gave for me on that cross. The passage we have to have is Mark 16:16. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he who does not believe does not have a chance at all because they can't even get to the point of believing. Let's go out. Let's use our faith word of God tells